The rolling hills of the Loran region provide a picturesque setting for the FAI World Hang Gliding Championships. Situated in southeast France, Loran-Chabre is roughly halfway between Marseille and Grenoble and is one of the country's best-known hang gliding sites. With a mostly dry and sunny climate and well-spaced ridges and valleys, it provides the ideal environment for a variety of cross-country flying tasks. The World Championships happen every 2 years, and this is the 17th time that they've been held. So the contest and the sport are well established, and this year 125 competitors from 33 different countries came to challenge for the title. Amongst them, triple Class 1 World Champion Manfred Rümer from Austria, reigning Class 5 World Champion Alessandro Plono from Italy, and USA team leader Jeff O'Brien. And of course, the French team was hoping to perform well at home. In the pioneering days of the sport, back in the early 1970s, pilots would literally hang by their arms onto the base bar of the glider. So the trick was to fly only as high as you dared to fall. Clearly that meant very short flights on relatively small hills. But the sport has developed, and with the pilots now securely suspended in a harness, they can travel huge distances. In fact, the world record for a single flight is over 700 kilometers. How then does a hang glider function? Well, to take off, the pilot's foot launch. In other words, the pilot faces into the wind and runs down a slope until they create enough speed and lift to get airborne. Once up in the air, the pilot is suspended beneath the wing, a 9-meter fabric sail which is stretched over an aluminium or graphite frame. Holding onto this A-frame, the pilots can then move themselves around like a pendulum, shifting their body weight to bank the hang glider one way or the other. To speed up, pilots pull themselves through the A-frame. The weight shifts forward and the hang glider goes into a nose-down position. And to lose speed, the pilots push the bar away from their bodies. This lifts the nose of the wing, which creates drag and slows the glider down. The World Championships comprise a series of races, or tasks, held over a two-week period. The tasks are actually point-to-point courses, with a series of checkpoints along the way. As you'd expect, the main objective is to reach the finish point as quickly as possible, and the longest course at these World Championships will be over 160 kilometres long. All in all then, the sport of hang gliding is akin to an aerial form of orienteering. After studying the day's weather forecast and wind direction, the organisers determine the launch site and the exact details of the task that will be set. Then it's time for the competitors to head for the mountains. One hour before the gliders take off, there's a general briefing. Once the course for the task has been finalised, it's handed out very precisely to all the pilots. They enter the various coordinates into their GPS navigation systems, including details of the target to be reached for the final landing. Once they know where they're going, the next stage is for the pilots to launch their gliders. Of course, with so many of them, it's impossible for everybody to take off together. So they head up one at a time and then circle above the mountain until everybody's ready to go. This period of waiting is used as an observation phase. It's a chance for the pilots to try and read the thermals and to try and read the movements and strategies of their competitors. The most vigilant pilot, the one who best reads the movements of the air and the changing conditions, is the one who will win the race. As the start time approaches, the pilots get themselves into position, trying to get as much altitude as possible. They're some 1,500 metres above the ground. They reach these considerable heights by flying into rising air. There are two causes of rising air. The first is called dynamic lift. That's when the wind hits a hillside or a mountain face and then rises upwards. If you've ever seen birds soaring above a cliff on a breezy day, that's dynamic lift. Then there's thermal lift. Thermal lift is caused by sun heating the ground. When a patch of ground gets hot enough, it starts to heat the air above it. Hot air rises, and that's your thermal. And the most efficient way for the pilots to stay in the lifting air is for them to fly around in circles. The technique is simply called thermaling. In the contest, the pilots hope to get enough altitude to be able to fly all the way to the finish, which can be anything from 100 to 160 kilometres away. And of course, they have to get there as quickly as possible. But it's not all downhill from here. By finding more climbing currents of air along the way, the pilots can reach dizzying heights of over 3,000 metres. All of this is hard work, both physically and mentally. A typical race will see the pilots in the air for up to 6 hours. Down on the ground, Raymond Coe, the French team manager, is constantly monitoring the progress of his pilots. He's in continuous radio contact with each of the pilots, providing as much advice as he can. What's more, each pilot informs teammates about the thermals they find. Some are to be sought out, while others are to be avoided, because not all thermals provide good lift. But at their best, the top pilots in the World Championship will be able to achieve average speeds of 50 kilometres an hour. After flying for several hours, the competitors reach goal. They have to cross the finish line as quickly as possible, and their GPS records the crossing time. After each task, the official FAI judges check that the turn points and the checkpoint beacons have all been crossed by the pilots. In other words, they make sure that none of the competitors has taken any shortcuts, and they do this by mapping the data from every pilot's GPS tracker. But it's not just about serious competition. For everybody taking part, the championships are as much about camaraderie and sharing their love of the sport as they are about winning.
Very good competition. Yes, we had difficult days with some of the weather, but they've flown quite a few good tasks now, and I think today is another very good task. So, yeah, they're going to have a world champion, and it will be somebody that really deserves the title. I think it's very close competition today. Trying to have fun as well, and we try to make lots of entertainment for them, as well as not just flying but other activities too, with the fête de la sport, fête de air, and the music and the meals, so everybody has more fun, not just flying.
After losing a couple of days through bad weather, the championships are reduced from 8 tasks to just 6. And with one flight to go, multiple world champion Manfred Rümer was leading the standings. But the final day turned into a disaster for the Austrian. He touched ground just after the first checkpoint and failed to reach the finish of the task. Rümer is a hang gliding legend, so when his fellow competitors heard the news, they were shell-shocked.
No.
Oui.
Ouais. No.
Oui. Premier point.
No. Oh, putain.
That poor final flight meant that Rümer dropped from first down to 10th overall, and it was a delighted Alessandro Plona that took the title, becoming the first ever Italian to do so. Confirmation of the final results then, Plona the champion, Australia's John Durand taking silver, with Austria's Thomas Weissenberger finishing in the bronze medal position. Zach Majors, Gordon Rigg and Antoine Boisselier also finishing inside the top 6. So, after 15 days of competition, the 17th FAI World Hang Gliding Championships draws to a close. It's been a busy fortnight, during which there have been over 1,200 launches, and the combined distance of all the pilots' flights has totaled a massive 67,000 kilometres. Hang gliding offers probably the most natural feeling of flying that anyone can experience. And for those lucky enough to take part, these championships offer a unique blend of sporting competition, peace, and adventure.